Today's Spirit of Democracy service honors the legacy of our late Minister Emeritus Jack Mendelson. A tireless advocate for racial justice, Jack served here at First Parish for nearly a decade, from 1979 to 1988. These are his words. Here in this sanctuary of ancient dreams and wisdom and beauty, we come to grow, to be healed, to stretch mind and heart, to be challenged, renewed, to be helped in our own continuing struggles for meaning and for love, to help build a world with more justice and mercy in it, to be counted among the hopers and doers. In the face of cynicism, darkness, brutality around us and within, we seek to align ourselves with a living community that would affirm rather than despair, that would think and act rather than simply adjust and succumb. Here, we invite the spirit of our own humanity and the healing powers under, around, through, and beyond it to give us the nerve and grace, the toughness and sensitivity to reach out, to search out the truth that frees and the life that maketh all things new.
So my job here is to introduce the first hymn, and of course we've got a climbing hymn, but this gives me an opportunity to say something else about Jack. Judith Fridiani, Jack's wife, is here in the front row, and one thing we can be sure of is that Jack would have loved to have been here with Bree Newsome. But this also reminds me of a story about Jack when he was called to the ministry of the Arlington Street Church in Boston. That was a prestigious Boston Brahmin kind of place, and there was a parishioner at Arlington Street, a woman named Mabel Daniels, who thought it was a little unseemly to have a senior minister with the name of Jack. She offered to pay his legal expenses to change his name to John. And Jack would have none of it. And Mabel Daniels probably never realized that on Jack's birth certificate, his name was Jacob. We are climbing Jacob's ladder is our first hymn, number 211. we join in the words of our unison affirmation. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. So be it.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to the first parish in Bedford, gathered in love and service for justice and peace. Here in this church, human beings have gathered for centuries seeking a higher purpose and deeper life than they could find alone. Together, we join as new visitors and old friends, lifted by the power of diversity, ever stirred by love's infinite possibilities, and seeking to become the people the world needs. We're so happy to have so many guests here in the room for this very special occasion, and we're so very, very lucky that Bree, Newsome has said yes to joining us. We're so, so very lucky and happy that you're here. Thank you for joining us. And John's going to introduce Bree a little bit more in a moment. We are aware that some folks may have trouble seeing when Bree comes to show some images up here, and if that's the case for you, feel free to make yourself comfortable. You can stand a little bit in the aisles here. You can also come and sit on the floor if that works for you. And later, when our kids head out to in-gathering, there may be some seats that open up, and you can move forward if that is something you'd like to do. In the back of your order of service, there's an announcement section. You can also check out one that's not in there. Over in Community Hour after the service, there's a table that is supporting the Standing Rock Sioux, who are protesting the pipeline. And you can support that table and learn more there. You can also stop by our welcome table, which is between here and the common room, and learn a little bit about us, tell us about you. There's a little blue connection card in your pew that you could fill out. It's a way to get our parishioner, our newsletter. And feel free to talk to anybody. If you are new here, make this place your home, and anybody who's been here a long time will be eagerly ready to connect with you. During the offering, if any one of you wants to help us continue this kind of event, the Spirit of Democracy event, we welcome checks and are very grateful for checks. And you could fill out the check with First Parish in the top line and Mendelssohn Fund in the memo line. After the service, you're invited to get some coffee in the common room and bring it back in here. We're going to have a chance to connect with Bree for about half an hour in here. And then for those who want some extended time with Bree, because who doesn't, we will also have lunch upstairs starting around noon. We're really glad every single one of you is here. Welcome, welcome, welcome. And I think John and Bree have a something they're going to share with the young people today.
So we're going to stand here for a second, and some of our younger kids and teachers are going to go off to their in-gathering, but before you do, I wanted to have a chance to introduce you to Bree Newsome, and I hope you'll have a chance to talk with her later. I'll tell more of Bree's story in a few minutes, but a small piece of her story is that for a number of years, the Confederate flag flew at the state capitol in South Carolina. And the Confederate flag has historically been a symbol of hatred, and it has encouraged people to do some very horrible things. And Bree, a little over a year ago, climbed the 30-foot flagpole at the state capitol in Columbia, South Carolina, and she pulled down the Confederate flag, and you may have seen the YouTubes. How many of you have seen the YouTubes of Bree on the pole? It was really remarkable, remarkable event. And so before the kids leave, I just wanted to ask you, Bree, if when you were young, when you were a kid, were there experiences that taught you something about fairness or justice or how people should be treated? What kind of message would you give to younger people?
Yes, certainly. So even when I was a child, and I think I have to give a lot of credit to my parents for making me aware of this. Both my parents were educators. And one of the things that they made sure that I knew from the time I was young was just to be aware of how much fortune I had, the ways in which I was fortunate that not every child was fortunate. And especially when it came to school, recognizing that there were resources, there were advantages that I had as a child that not every child had. And that what came with that blessing, what came with those advantages was also a responsibility to work toward equality and greater opportunity for all people. And I think that's a really important thing that comes with blessings, is that there is a responsibility for us to advocate and minister in one way or another, to really work for everyone to have an opportunity and to share in those blessings.
Wonderful. We're going to have lots more to say as it goes along. And I do hope that kids will introduce yourself to Bree a little later. Now is a good time for those that are going off to in-gathering to go. And Bob, would you give us a little traveling music?
Hi there. From July 14th through the 18th, hundreds of residents marched the Massachusetts route of Spectra Energy's proposed pipeline project all the way to the State House. First parishioner Brown Pulliam trekked for 2 days of that walk, and I joined in for 9 miles the second day. We were taking a rest, and I was talking about my frustration and anger at the sneaky way Spectra had wormed its way into Massachusetts with little transparency. But Brown said that it didn't make him angry because he didn't expect people at Spectra to behave differently. They were doing exactly what is normal for an energy company. And then Brown said, "But I just wish more people would get involved." This sparked much food for thought by a careful fence sitter like me, and a month later, I was in the West Roxbury Pipeline Trench with others, including Brown, getting arrested for trespassing and disturbing the peace. The immediate aftermath of my arrest and my own highly personal and empowering response has been short-lived, and here's why. The specific Spectra Energy Pipeline project to pump high-pressured fracked gas to our area and beyond our shores to more lucrative overseas markets and the transfer station in West Roxbury are just about done. In truth, I tried to block construction on a pipeline that is finished for all intents and purposes. That's in spite of a study by the Attorney General's Office of the state's projected natural gas needs that conclude that building new pipelines would be the most costly alternative for Massachusetts ratepayers to meet their energy needs, even in the worst case scenario. And that a 2014 Harvard University study calculated the total cost of lost gas through leaks of existing gas lines to be $90 million per year in the greater Boston area. That's $90 million per year of lost gas through leaks. Any perceived energy need could easily be met by fixing these leaks. I could go on and on, listing all the reasons why the West Roxbury Pipeline and the others throughout the Northeast and beyond and the practice of fracking are dangerous, unhealthy, and contribute big time to climate change. It's not just one pipeline in my backyard. The bigger picture is that overwhelming evidence and agreement among scientists point to climate change that is real, global, and calamitous. The pipeline represents, for me, business driven by greed and corporate misconduct, with little attention paid to the communities most impacted by their opaque practices. It reflects the far bigger problem that government, business, and people aren't coming together to address the most pressing issue of our time. Fracked gas is aptly named. We are fractured. We are fracked. But I'm not giving up, because as these words by visionary Derek Jensen so eloquently express, I'm in love with salmon, with trees outside my window, with baby lampreys living in sandy stream bottoms, with slender salamanders crawling through the duff. And if you love, you act to defend your beloved. Of course, results to you matter, but they don't determine whether or not you make the effort. You don't simply hope your beloved survives and thrives. You do what it takes. If my love doesn't cause me to protect those I love, it's not love.
This is a good opportunity for the great words of Bonaro Overstreet. You say the little efforts that I make will do no good. They never will prevail to tip the hovering scale where justice hangs in balance. I don't think I ever thought they would, but I am prejudiced beyond debate in favor of my right to choose which side shall feel the stubborn ounces of my weight. Freely we have received, freely give for the good work of this congregation within and far, far beyond these walls. Our morning offering will gratefully be received.
Thank you.
So before the service, our state senator, Mike Barrett, was with me in my office with Bree and reminded Bree that she has come to a pole-climbing town. For those of you who don't know this, around Patriots Day, we have pole capping day, where one of our Minutemen, of whom I am the chaplain, climbs the pole. I certainly don't climb the pole, but one of the Minutemen climbed the pole and put a red Liberty cap on the top of the pole, and it is one of the high holy days in Bedford, and you're invited to come and climb that pole anytime. And I don't know how I left that out of my introduction, but I did. Here's my introduction of Bree. So about a year ago, I got a call from my friend, Bedford resident, and gadfly, Rachel Murphy. Rachel, by the way, calls herself a Baptist Unitarian. And Rachel excitedly said, "I just learned that the woman who climbed the pole and pulled down that Confederate flag was my cousin, Bree Newsome." So that is how today happened. I played the cousin card. Oh, your Massachusetts cousin sure would like to see you. Which is true. And Rachel and Ed, you did this favor once before, several years ago. We had your college classmate, Jabril Kazan, speak here. I played the college classmate card because Jabril was one of the four young men who were arrested in 1960 for sitting in at the Woolworth's lunch counter in Greensboro, South Carolina. South Carolina, North Carolina. Now I'm in real trouble, yeah. There's a photo of Jabril over by the offices if you want to see it. They were great heroes, of course. And then a year ago, our Spirit of Democracy speaker was 350.org founder Bill McKibben. His mother lives in Bedford. The mother card, oh, come see your mother, Bill. And McKibben came to us and he said, "Some of you young people may not want an arrest on your record, but what about the rest of you?" And Diane and a whole lot of us have been getting arrested ever since. It is not coincidental that many who have inspired us here at First Parish have arrest records. Helen Caldicott, Phil Berrigan, Al Sharpton, Jack Mendelson, Henry David Thoreau, and yes, Jesus as well. Not putting up with things that are morally wrong is an inherently hopeful thing. Hope is why we are here at church. Hope is what we so desperately need, and I don't need to tell you, never more than today. Michael Moore's new movie, Where to Invade Next, is filled with the hopeful conviction that our stubborn ounces matter. At the end of the film, he shows people hammering down the Berlin Wall, and then the credits run, and what comes on the screen after the credits, the very final thing? News footage of Bree Newsome on the flagpole. Bree is the piece de resistance. And in resistance, in resistance, there is hope. Anna Deavere Smith's new one-woman play, Notes from the Field, is about the school-to-prison pipeline and the racist epidemic of mass incarceration. But the final scene in that play is with Anna Deavere Smith channeling the hopeful words and actions of two people, Congressman John Lewis and Bree Newsome. Hope gets in the last word. Heroes of hope. In June of 2015, the massacre of 9 people at Charleston's Mother Emanuel Church by a shooter who had photographed himself waving the Confederate flag was the final insult to the conscience of Bree and her accomplices. Inaction was not an option. We must remember that the Confederate flag is not some old memento of the Confederacy. After the Civil War, most of those flags were put away and more or less forgotten. But in the 20th century, they were brought out again in response to the progress of the civil rights movement, because that flag was originally designed and intended to strike fear into those who would challenge the power of slavers and segregationists. Its essential purpose is to be a hateful warning to any who would challenge white supremacy. Well, we don't see too many Confederate flags around here. We don't know the difference between North Carolina and South Carolina. But around here nonetheless, we see plenty of hate in the news, and we see plenty of white supremacy. Just look around. Bree is an artist, a filmmaker, and recipient of the 2016 NAACP Image Award. Today, she is in the thick of the police and community crisis in her hometown of Charlotte, in the state of North Carolina, that is still reeling from Hurricane Matthew. Bree is a hope-filled courage teacher. Coming down from the pole, she kept repeating the 27th Psalm, "The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear?" The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Please welcome Rachel's cousin, Bree Newsome. Bree.
Thank you so much. I just feel so overwhelmingly, just tremendously blessed. I mean, that's how I feel all the time. And I feel like I've had a very blessed life. But particularly in the past year, I mean, having the honor and the blessing and the mission to travel and speak. After removing the flag, I started getting all these invitations to, you know, travel and speak. And, you know, in the beginning, it was people saying, "Well, why did you do that?" And I was like, "That's a good question. Let me come and speak to you and explain why." Because if you have that question, we should definitely take some time to talk about it. But you know, just including today, and I thank you so much, Reverend Gibbons, for the warm reception that I have received. I got to meet my cousin for the first time in person, and that has been amazing. So just my time here so far has been a blessing, and I really look forward to later today when I'll have hopefully an opportunity to talk with some of you more, either during the conversation time or maybe over lunch. But I, again, just thank you so much. In the modern movement, we use this term conscious a lot. I don't know if you've heard people speak that way about somebody being conscious or unconscious. And we use that term really to describe our awareness of history, our awareness of the systems at work within society. I mean, white supremacy is a term that, you know, we use. This is a term that has developed over time to describe the system in which we live, right? It wasn't like back in 1519, people sat around a table and said, let's create white supremacy. That's not what happened. And often, if you look at the biography of activists or organizers, and this is pretty much anyone, whether it's King or Gandhi or any of these folks, you'll usually find in their life story that there's a moment where there's a shift in their consciousness. You become aware of maybe a cause that you weren't aware of before and an aspect to society that you weren't aware of before. And it's usually that moment that sparks you towards change and towards committing a larger part of your life to the cause of justice. And I'll talk some about my own personal shift in my consciousness. But I also want to say to you that some things I say today might be jarring to your consciousness or to your belief system, to your awareness and where you're at right now. And I just want to ask that all of us be willing to lean into discomfort somewhat, not just as people gathered in this room, but as people of this nation, as people of this world, as people of this time. We are living in a time where there are changes that have to be made. And in order for us to make those changes, it's going to require a certain level of discomfort and uncomfortable conversations that have to be had. So I ask that we be willing to, again, lean into that discomfort and allow some of our perceptions to be challenged. So I like to begin, I always like to begin this presentation with a simple demonstration in this idea of unconscious versus conscious, but I need you to participate with me. Is that okay? Okay, so if everybody could sit up straight, we're just gonna take some deep breaths together, very simple. Okay, ready? So breathe in, breathe out, breathe in, breathe out. That was it, that was the demonstration. Very simple. So what happened in that moment, breathing is an automatic body function, right? This is something that you do without thinking about it. It would be really difficult if you had to be conscious of every single breath that you take with all the other functions that your body is trying to do, which is why it is an automatic body function. But what happened in that moment when we all paused to concentrate on our breath was we became conscious of an unconscious behavior. From the time we are babies, as we grow, as we interact with society, we are socialized into holding thought patterns, beliefs, customs, and social roles, and we act these roles out, often unconsciously. So again, what does it mean to be conscious? Most simply, it means to be aware of unconscious behavior. I'm aware that I am a Black woman, but I am also aware that race, as it is understood in the United States, is a social construct with no real basis in biology. I'm aware that all modern humans on Earth belong to one species, Homo sapiens sapiens, which first appeared in Africa some 200,000 years ago. I'm aware that those first human beings were materially no different than we are. I'm aware that the common journey of humanity from then until now has been the evolution of our collective consciousness, our shared knowledge and understanding of the world around us passed on from generation to generation, often through art and creativity and history. It is this shared understanding of reality that forms the basis of human culture. I'm aware that I live within a particular time and place in human history where racism, the idea that members of each race possess certain characteristics, especially to create a hierarchy as to who's better or worse at certain things, is a defining element of the cultural consciousness. And I just want to point out, I'm a visual learner, so I like to have visuals that, I saw somebody else raise their hand. Yeah, so I like to have visuals that accompany what I'm talking about. And just to explain what this image is here on the left, this is a casta. This was something that was common, especially in Latin America during slavery, where they would define all the different races. So again, understanding that race, this concept of race, is something that was developed over time. I'm also aware that it has not always been this way, The idea that dark skin is indicative of negative traits like unintelligence, laziness, poverty, and a subhuman identity is a modern phenomenon that emerged only with the rise of the transatlantic slave trade, and only because such racist beliefs were necessary to justify the enslavement and systematic torture of my ancestors who were kidnapped from West Africa. Of course, I wasn't born with this consciousness. The process of going from unconscious to conscious is a choice an individual must make. It's a process of inquiry in which one must be willing to engage, to consider the reality that exists outside of one's immediate experience. The summer of 2013 was a pivotal time in the awakening of my sociopolitical consciousness. I had recently returned to North Carolina after serving as artist in residence at Saatchi & Saatchi Ad Agency in New York City. And it was during that summer that my family and I visited the Old Slave Mart Museum in Charleston, South Carolina, a small building that was once part of a much larger complex in which enslaved Africans were once auctioned off like cattle. I stood there with my family, and I contemplated the unbearable thought of what it would mean to depart that slave mart to a place unknown where I might never see my family again. Perhaps taken to a place like the plantation in Rembert, South Carolina, where my third great-grandparents were enslaved on the eve of the Civil War, where, according to my third great-grandmother, Minerva Diggs, she prayed to God every night that her children would see freedom. That moment in the slave mart stirred my soul, and I felt a deeper connection to the struggle of my ancestors. The past seemed to be rising in the summer of 2013, and not in good ways. It was also in this year that the U.S. Supreme Court invalidated key parts of the Voting Rights Act, permitting states in the South to change their election laws without advance federal approval. My home state of North Carolina wasted no time in creating new election laws clearly designed to make it harder for blacks, poor people, and students to vote. Laws that made it abundantly clear why the Voting Rights Act existed in the first place. I was in Raleigh, North Carolina in late July when a friend invited me out to a Moral Monday protest responding to the attack on voting rights. For those unfamiliar, if I'm not mistaken, you have some familiarity with Moral Monday, right? Yeah, okay, so I probably don't have to give as, but if there's anyone in the room who's not familiar, Moral Monday is a series of protests first begun by the North Carolina State Chapter of the NAACP and Reverend William Barber. And at that point in 2013, every Monday, they would march to the Capitol in Raleigh and lift up a different issue. Sometimes it was healthcare, it was the attack on Medicaid, different things. The march that I went out to was specifically around voting rights. And as I said, I had just come back from New York and was really kind of plugging into what was going on. And part of what really struck me and had such an impact on me, not only the vicious attack on voting rights, which just shocked me to recognize how quickly those rights could be eroded, but also just the amount of young people. There were so many people my age, and so many of them had already volunteered to be arrested, doing sit-ins and all of these things. And so it really caused me to pause and check and ask myself, what am I doing? You know, I see all these people really stepping up and taking this kind of risk for democracy. And it really made me question whether or not I had taken a lot of things for granted and perhaps was not doing enough to really help. And so I volunteered to participate in a sit-in that following Wednesday and agreed to be arrested at a voting rights sit-in. And just to give you some update on that, if you're not familiar as well, we recently had a ruling by the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals, because obviously there are a lot of lawsuits filed over these voter suppression laws. And that ruling, to quote the judges, they said that the state of North Carolina had targeted African Americans with surgical precision. Some of the things that they did was ending voting on Sundays, because that was a day that was highly favored by African Americans. We have a thing called Souls to the Polls, where people would usually leave church and then march to the polls to vote. They also attacked early voting because it was preferred by African Americans. Since that time, the case went to the Supreme Court and the law was struck down, so that law will not be in effect in North Carolina for the elections coming up. And that's really a testament to, people have put in a lot of work. There has been a lot of blood, sweat, and tears that have gone into fighting that, and so they are to be commended for that. Something else very key happened in 2013. George Zimmerman was acquitted in the murder of Trayvon Martin. A 17-year-old unarmed black teenager walking in the neighborhood where he lived had been profiled, stalked, accosted, shot, and killed in an act of vigilante violence that's painfully familiar to African Americans. His killer was arrested only after 6 weeks of intense national protest. For many of us, the case evoked visions of Emmett Till, a 14-year-old African-American teenager from Chicago who was lynched while visiting family in Mississippi and whose racist killers were acquitted of their crimes. Like many, I was deeply disturbed by the facts and circumstances surrounding Trayvon's death. Something else that I like to do is make reference to history, draw these historical parallels so that we are aware of the larger context that informs what's happening today. And I always encourage people, if there's anything that I reference up here that is new to you that you haven't heard before, I strongly encourage you to go and learn more about it. Very similar to Trayvon, Emmett Till's case, which happened in 1955, was definitely a sparking moment for the civil rights movement of the 50s and 60s. And as I said, like Emmett Till's case, Trayvon's case sparked a new movement led by black and brown youth who saw themselves in Trayvon. One such group was the Dream Defenders, a group of black and Latinx students who, following the verdict in the Zimmerman trial, staged an occupation of the Florida State Capitol for several weeks. I traveled with a group of activists from North Carolina to Florida to visit the Dream Defenders during their occupation of the State House, and was inspired by both their vigor and their innovative styles of protest. One of the things that they would do that was really awesome, so down in Tallahassee, they have a new state house that they've built. I'm not sure when they built the new one, but they still have their old state house kind of preserved as a tourist site. And one of the things that the Dream Defenders would do every day, they would go over and sit in at the legislative session at the state house. Then they would get up, march out, you know, very dramatically in a demonstration, march across to the old state house, and then hold their own legislative session with the youth. And I thought that was really, it was very powerful. But Florida wasn't alone. Millennial activist groups sprang up everywhere. Groups like Black Youth Project 100 in Chicago and Million Hoodies for Justice in New York City. This is the movement for Black lives. And I was excited to be a part of it, to be part of a cause much greater than myself, to help carry forward the banner for freedom, equality, and justice. We would later learn that the Trayvon Martin case had not only inspired a new generation of young freedom fighters, but also the man who would go on to massacre 9 black parishioners during a prayer meeting at Mother Emanuel AME Church in Charleston, South Carolina. In his racist manifesto that surfaced after the killings, Dylan Roof wrote, quote, "The event that truly awakened me was the Trayvon Martin case." The violence we saw this past summer is not unprecedented, of course. There's a long history of racist violence aimed at black churches because of their historical role as hubs of black community organization and the vital role black churches have played in the ongoing civil rights movement. Roof targeted Mother Emanuel specifically for this reason. And the case I'm referencing here is the 16th Street Baptist Church bombing. Again, if you're not familiar with this case, a very important case to be aware of. I mean, there were a series in the 60s, especially in Alabama, a series of attacks on churches, burnings, bombings. This is one of the most famous ones. This is the case of the four little girls who were killed. If you've seen the film Selma, there's reference made to that in the opening of the film. And I like to point out to people as well that in addition to the massacre that happened in Charleston last year, there was also a series of church burnings throughout the South, including in my hometown of Charlotte, North Carolina. Roof traveled to Charleston from Columbia, South Carolina, where since 1962, a Confederate flag had flown above the state capitol as a statement of white supremacist power, as a symbol of defiance against the civil rights movement and increasing pressure from the federal government to desegregate. Being a child of the South myself and descended from a family that has been in the Carolinas for hundreds of years, the meaning of the Confederate flag was never lost on me. It was a banner that first represented slavery, and then, after the South lost the war, it became emblematic of the Jim Crow laws that would govern the South for the next 100 years, laws designed to control and limit the political and economic power of the free black population, laws undergirded by a culture of racial terror whereby black people could be murdered simply for attempting to vote. Like many black families in the South, my own has experienced this violence. My great uncle, who was lynched in Goldsboro, North Carolina, so a white man could take his son's newspaper stand. Or my grandmother, who as a child in Greenville, South Carolina, witnessed the Ku Klux Klan drag her neighbor from his house and beat him in the middle of the street simply because he was a black physician who provided treatment to a white woman. And though the trauma of such events has led to a climate where we don't discuss these events openly or often, it is the pervasive threat of such violence that made the Confederate flag in Columbia, South Carolina, seemingly untouchable for so many years. I think it's important to point out, too, that this particular flag in South Carolina over the state capitol had always been controversial. One of the kind of mistaken narratives that came out in the news last year was that this flag only became controversial in the wake of the massacre, and that's obviously not true at all. For many years, the NAACP had led a boycott of the state over this issue. The NCAA refused to host championship games there. Side note, the NCAA is now refusing to host games in North Carolina. North Carolina is running for the title of South Carolina, if you haven't been paying attention. And that's part of why we get offended when you say North Carolina and South Carolina are the same. No, but it's really true. It's pretty frightening what's happening in North Carolina right now. Please, if you haven't been paying attention, HB 972, this is a House bill they passed, just went into effect that now you have to go through the court systems to get access to police body camera footage. We're still fighting over HB 2. This is a law that says that you cannot sue the state for discrimination. I mean, there's a lot of, it's a massive attack on civil rights that's happening in North Carolina right now. But I myself remember watching television in 2000 when, you know, they had this, I mean, most belabored act of compromise on the part of the legislature over this flag in South Carolina. They finally agreed to move it from the dome of the Capitol to the lawn. And they also at that time made this decision that, okay, we won't touch any more Confederate monuments and we won't touch any civil rights monuments. So it was, you know, they kind of just came to this impasse to agree to disagree by placing it on the lawn. In fact, at one point, a protester put a ladder up against the pole, climbed to the top, set the flag on fire. South Carolina built a 4-foot-tall spoked fence around it, which if you've seen the video, you see James and I having to hop over that in the course of our own action. The thing is that so much blood, we don't even know how many people have died in the cause up until this point, fighting for racial equity. And tragically, it took the blood of 9 more innocent people to finally shake the conscience of this nation surrounding that symbol of slavery, hatred, and terrorism that is the Confederate flag. As long as I live, I will never forget the night of the Charleston massacre. It shook me to my core that here we were in 2015, and this level of racial hatred and terrorism was still happening in America. I will never forget the day after, when, like many cities around the nation, we held a vigil for the victims and survivors of the massacre in Charlotte, North Carolina, at Little Rock, a local AME church with its own history of involvement in the ongoing civil rights movement. I remember being asked by a reporter that night what I thought the next steps were. I said I didn't know. To be honest, as a Christian, I had a crisis of faith at that moment. The people who gathered for Bible study in Emmanuel AME Church that night, Cynthia Marie Graham Hurd, Susie Jackson, Ethel Lee Lance, DePayne Middleton Doctor, Tawanza Sanders, Daniel Simmons, Sharonda Coleman Singleton, Myra Thompson, and Reverend Clementa Pinckney, rest in peace, were only doing what Christians are called to do when anyone knocks on the doors of the church. Invite them into fellowship and worship. I want to pause for a minute to remind everyone of some larger context that was happening at that time that the massacre occurred in Charleston, South Carolina. I don't know if you recall the Walter Scott case. This is a case that happened in North Charleston where a passerby just happened to, you know, be walking by and with his cell phone caught footage of Officer Michael Slager shooting and killing Walter Scott while he was running away and then walking up and trying to plant evidence on the body. And just to give you a sense of the climate there, this person who recorded this video did not feel safe going to the police with what he had seen. He went to and found a lawyer, and then with his lawyer, they released it to the media instead of going to the police. Reverend Pinckney was a state legislator who, shortly before being assassinated, had succeeded in getting body camera legislation passed there in Charleston. So again, I like to remind people that what happened in Charleston falls on really kind of two historical timelines. There is this more recent timeline of mass shootings that we've had in this country, but there's also this much longer timeline of attacks on civil rights workers, civil rights leaders, and black churches. A sense of shock and demoralization had overtaken the movement. As photos surfaced of Dylann Roof burning the American flag while waving the Confederate flag, there was a renewed sense of outrage over the state's continued endorsement of this hate symbol. By this point, I had become an organizer in my local community, and I had no intentions of getting arrested again at the time. But I determined that an action to take down the flag was a cause for which I would definitely risk getting arrested again. I was so deeply convicted on the issue that I had seriously contemplated attempting the climb myself, having no real climbing experience. It was actually a Greenpeace activist who trained me on how to climb. She had experience scaling trees, and so she taught me how to scale the pole. But at that point, I had no climbing experience, so I was pretty certain I'd be arrested before making it to the top. But I still felt so strongly that the point must be made how absolutely intolerable it was for that flag to fly another day, especially as the United States and state flags flew beneath it at half staff. It was at a meeting the Tuesday evening before the action that I met many of my cohorts in the action for the first time, including James Tyson, who I feel demonstrated great moral courage when he helped me across the fence and stood guard as I climbed. History will rightly remember him alongside the many white allies who over the centuries have risked their own safety and in some cases spilled their own blood in defense of black life and in the name of freedom. In fact, at one point, when I got about halfway up the pole, up until that point, there were like two officers at the bottom and we were kind of having this conversation, you can see it in the video, where they're like, ma'am, come down. And I'm like, no, I will not. But at one point, a police supervisor came on. I mean, we were having this conversation, but it was staying peaceful. And a supervisor came over and directed the officers at the bottom to tase me. Now, of course, I'm attached to a metal pole. This could have electrocuted me. And at that point, James grabbed the pole and he said, if you electrocute her, you'll have to electrocute me too. And then they backed away. Also, I want to point out, if you're not familiar with this case as well, if you've seen the film, I'm a filmmaker, so I always make references to film as a way to learn about things, but this is a case that's referenced in the film Mississippi Burning. These are the civil rights workers who went missing during Freedom Summer 1964 and were later discovered that they had been murdered by the Klan working in collaboration with the police in Mississippi. But it was with this awareness of history that we chose to attack a symbol of systemic racism with a direct action that symbolized its dismantling. We discussed it and decided to remove the flag immediately, both as an act of civil disobedience and as a demonstration of the power people have when we work together. Achieving this would require many roles, including, of course, someone who must volunteer to scale the pole and remove the flag. Everybody wanted to do that. There wasn't a person who didn't want to climb up and snatch the flag. Not everybody could put themselves at risk of being arrested. There were about 10 to 12 of us involved in this. Several of them were teachers who just simply couldn't, run that risk of getting arrested. A couple of them lived in South Carolina, had real fear for their safety and for their family being so close to it. But once I volunteered and it was clear that this role would be going to a black woman, we talked through some more of the symbolism. What do we want to communicate visually with this action? And we decided as a collective that it should be a white man who helps me over the fence and stands guard as I climb, putting his own body on the line in a show of solidarity. And we made this decision because for us, this is not, nor has this ever just been about a flag. But rather it is about abolishing the spirit of hatred and oppression in all its forms. I bring everything I have to the cause of freedom. It's a conscious choice I have made to dedicate myself to the causes of democracy and liberation, even to the point of putting my own body on the line. Why? Because I've examined what's at stake for me if I don't. But perhaps even more than that, I've examined the past and I've asked, What was at stake each time Harriet Tubman risked her life making a journey south to usher more souls to freedom? What was at stake when Gandhi was tossed from a train in South Africa and had to make a choice whether to accept this treatment or to protest? Where would we be today were it not for people who recognized what was at stake in the times in which they lived? When I consider what's at stake in our time, I think also of the future. I ask, what am I doing as an individual? What gifts, what talents, what skills, what resources, what time am I contributing to the collective effort to better humanity? This is a time of great turmoil, obviously. I've been giving this speech for a year, and it seems like this one line only becomes more true as I say it. You turn on the news, and a lot of what you see is violence and unrest. The most consistent message seems to be one of fear. Turmoil isn't something we have to fear, however. Turmoil is an indication that the ground is ripe for sowing the seeds of social change. Every period of awakening and advancement in human history has been marked by turmoil, and it's true that the darkest hour is right before dawn. So I embrace this as a time of transformation and promise. I feel blessed to work at a grassroots level in my community where I witness the kind of cooperation, innovation, and courage that springs to life when people work together for the betterment of all. It's important that when we give of ourselves, that we do it with an understanding of service leadership. That leadership is first and foremost about service and sacrifice for others, and that giving is first and foremost about grace. Everyone is a leader. This is a concept prominent in the modern movement that seems to cause confusion for some. But the concept that everyone is a leader is not simply about abolishing hierarchies in leadership, but also about establishing collective responsibility. Everyone can help lead the way toward a just society. Everyone carries with them skills, talents, life experience, and knowledge that is valuable to this world. And everyone can apply what they have to the cause of justice. I often get the question, what can I do? People witness daily injustices and societal illnesses and can feel powerless and overwhelmed by it all. One doesn't have to be an activist in the traditional sense of the word to be impactful. Like, a lot of times people think, if I want to be an activist, I got to scale a pole like Bree Newsome. Fortunately, no. I'm glad that everybody doesn't have to scale a pole. It would make it a lot harder. Civil disobedience and public protest are essential to achieving democracy. I think they always have been. I think they always will be. But justice doesn't come only in the streets. Every person has within them the ability to be an agent of change. We need all hands on deck, people in every field and from every walk of life. Everyone must ask themselves, what is at stake in these times? It's also very important that we not allow purpose to get lost in process. Sometimes we get so caught in the back and forth of how that we forget why. We can get so caught up on models and statistics and methods and theories that we lose sight of humanity. Ultimately, the root of all our social issues is a basic question of, what does it mean to be human? How does our understanding of what it means to be human inform the way in which we order society? How does our understanding of what it means to be human inform the way in which we interact with each other? I've been praised a lot for my courage, but I want to point out that courage is not about the absence of fear, but rather the belief in something greater than that fear and the determination to fight for it. I faced tremendous fear after I volunteered to climb the flagpole. And I think that's something important to remember as Christians as well. Because I prayed a lot before agreeing to climb the flagpole, and I definitely received in my spirit, I had a calming in my spirit that this was for me to do. That didn't mean that the fear went away. Absolutely not. And it's at those times where I had to lean on my faith most of all. And in that moment when I was praying about it, I thought especially of past freedom fighters. I thought especially of the freedom riders specifically. These people who boarded buses and traveled south in deliberate violation of segregation laws during the 60s. And I thought of the courage it took for them to make that journey, not knowing what would greet them or if they would even return alive. I understood the risk involved in what I was doing. I understood there was reason to fear what might happen. Yet I also understand that as a human being, the measure of my humanity is linked to my ability to recognize the humanity of others. I knew that I had become part of something bigger than myself. The universal struggle of humanity toward a society that is truly free and that truly recognizes the rights of all individuals. This is the cause greater than myself that I risked my life for and that I continue to fight for. In terms of where we go from here in this continued fight for social justice, I believe it is crucial that we recognize both the systemic and global nature of racial injustice. We have to move towards a human rights framework which recognizes the struggle for racial justice in America as being part of a universal struggle for education, housing, democracy, and equal protection under the law. We must address the wealth inequality that exists from centuries of racial oppression and economic exploitation. We must address the systemic injustice that brings generational poverty to cities and rural communities alike, that brings police brutality to both West Baltimore and to Palestine. What we did in South Carolina was a symbolic action that was perhaps as powerful as a symbolic action can be. The fact is, however, that symbols don't make reality what it is. That's one of my favorite ones, too. Symbols don't make reality what it is. The Confederate flag flew for 63 years over the South Carolina State House. The simple fact of the flag flying there isn't what kept Black Americans oppressed. The flag symbolized the oppression. But the oppression itself is the result of racist policies and social practices that continue to this day. To effect real change, we must end policies that perpetuate racial disparity and injustice. You know, we love to speak of dreams in this country. This is a nation of dreamers. The American dream, the dream of Dr. King. But a dream continually deferred is not a plan of action, nor is it intended to be. The only thing that will sustain us as a society is not deferred dreams, but the proactive work of dismantling the current system of oppression and exploitation in favor of systems, laws, and ways of being that both affirm human rights and respect the living earth. Very lofty language. What does that look like practically? I'm a very practical, concrete kind of person, thinker. So working at a grassroots level in my community in Charlotte, North Carolina, as Reverend Gibbons mentioned, one of the main things we're looking at right now is sustainable organization. This means moving the community from a place of always being in reactionary mode to things that are happening. So most recently, as Reverend Gibbons mentioned, we just had another police killing in Charlotte about 3 weeks ago now, and since then have had a lot of protest and violence and unrest since then. But what we want to do is really move the community toward a place of being organized to the point where we can prevent these kinds of things from happening in the first place. This requires having economic and political infrastructure. One of the hallmarks of oppressed communities is that they have neither of these. And just to give you some background on where I'm organizing in Charlotte, Charlotte, very typical of many major cities around the nation. We have a lot of prosperity, we have a lot of business going on, but we also have tremendous wealth inequality. In fact, Charlotte-Mecklenburg, they did a study about 3 years ago, and Charlotte-Mecklenburg rated 50th, in terms of economic mobility. So a child born into poverty in Charlotte statistically gets poorer over the course of his or her lifetime. And in fact, people who now qualify as middle class in Charlotte are at higher risk of also falling into poverty. So in order for us to correct this situation, we have to address both the economic oppression that is happening in terms of low wages, the lack of affordable housing, and we have to address the political oppression that's happening in terms of the constant alienation of people from the political process. Part of this requires local leadership development. We really believe in helping those who have been living in the neighborhood in these communities for a long time really develop into being leaders within their community. We don't simply want to parachute in as, you know, the rescue organizers and lead the way. We really want to be there to support the community becoming empowered itself. Mass popular political education is very important. I'm not sure what the situation here is in Massachusetts, but in addition to the attack on voting rights, we've had a severe attack on civics education. It's like anything that would encourage people to participate in the process is under attack. We used to have this thing called Civics Day, where 16-year-olds would learn about, you know, the whole process, and then they could pre-register to vote. So when they turned 18, they would be ready to vote. They did away with that. So we're trying to supplement that by creating spaces within the community where we can teach people What does a county commissioner do? Why is it important for you to care about this Fourth Circuit judge? Things like that. Building bridges between generations is really important. A lot of the divide that we have going on right now is not only racial, it's not only economic, it's also generational. And there are a number of reasons for that. For instance, the school-to-prison pipeline, we had some mention of that earlier, this process whereby children are being systematically forced out of school and into the prison system, this is something that has developed since the integration of schools, specifically as one of those counter-integration methods. And sometimes I find folks who are from an older generation, they assume that children just don't want to go to school, or they just don't care about their education. They're not recognizing that the schools are actually being turned into hostile environments. They didn't have police stationed in their classrooms when they were coming up. We now have police stationed in their classrooms. Things that used to be a matter for the principal and for the school system are now criminal issues. Before Charlotte, I was organizing in Durham, we had an instance there of a student being arrested for having a water bottle in school. Latino student had a water bottle in school. Other kids had water bottles, no problem. So the criminalization of children and youth and students is also a problem. Self-care, this is something that I really emphasize, not only for organizers and activists, but anyone in any kind of role of leadership or volunteer kind of role. The thing that we all tend to have in common is that we tend to be very empathic people. We tend to really love to give of ourselves, and that's wonderful and beautiful. The downside of it is that sometimes we don't know how to take care of ourselves and give to ourselves as well. And the problem with that is that if you don't care for yourself, you can easily burn out. And once you burn out, you have nothing left to give to the folks who need you to show up. So I really emphasize self-care. Healthcare and healing spaces, something else that we're working on in our community. Healthcare in terms of our physical well-being and the access to healthcare, again, access to healthcare very much under attack in North Carolina right now, but also healing spaces. And when I say healing spaces, I don't mean in that corporatist establishment sense where after a tragedy happens, they say, oh, let's come together and heal, but not really deal with anything. That's not what I mean. But really creating spaces within the communities that are dealing with trauma and generational trauma to have a place for them to heal. That's something that we've had to do a lot, especially in recent weeks in the wake of the Keith Scott shooting. In order to do all of this, we have to end systemic displacement. Another common word for it is gentrification. I prefer the term systemic displacement because I think systemic displacement explains more why it's an issue. The influx of money into the community is not an issue. We need economic growth in the community. We want home values to rise in our community. But we need that to happen for the folks who have been living there for 50 years. So to give you an example of like where I organize in West Charlotte, again, a neighborhood that has been highly segregated for decades. The city, because it is predominantly black, has divested from the schools there. If you go and look at like West Charlotte High School and then compare it to a high school in South Charlotte where it's a much wealthier area, you would not think that these were in the same school system. You'd be shocked to see that these belong to the same school system. And the home values of folks who have been living here since like the 40s, their prices, their home values stay stagnant because of the poverty, because of the city's deliberate lack of investment in those communities. Then what happens is once it becomes prime real estate again, as my community has because of its accessibility to downtown, then they start building larger houses, investing money, which then because of the hike in taxes, forces the folks who had homes for there out, so that had homes there for a long time out of the community, so they're not able to grow their wealth. And we know that in America, home ownership is one of the main ways that you are able to build wealth. So again, this becomes an issue of economic justice. We want to talk about how we build wealth for the people who have been living in this community for a long time. And faith. Faith is very important. And I speak of faith not only in the personal sense for me. My faith as a Christian, as a follower of Christ, very much informs my activism and my commitment to people and to justice and to equality. But I also speak in a more general sense. One of the things I like to point out to people, and I think sometimes it's hard for us to conceive in this modern age, but there was really a time when the idea of a United States without slavery, without chattel slavery, was inconceivable. I think sometimes it's hard for us to imagine, but it was the economy. Like if you haven't heard, we fought a civil war over it. was a pretty big deal. And the only reason that we're in this space today as we are is because there were people who lived at that time who had faith that it could be different. And in order for us to have a future that is different, we have to have that same kind of faith now. And I know it seems crazy when people are talking about police reform and abolishing prisons and all of these things. That seems so out there. Like, how can you possibly have a society without these things? But just remember, there was a time when people thought that it was inconceivable to be without chattel slavery. We have to have that same kind of radical faith now. I can't end without touching on social media, because this is just such a pivotal, important part of not just the movement, but of modern society. So first of all, it's important to understand that we are actually living at a time where media has never been so consolidated. So you have about five corporations that control about 90% of all media platforms. That's radio, newspaper, television, everything, all of these outlets. So to have such a high, at the time of such high consolidation of media, to also have at that same time a device that people, everyday people, can carry in their pocket and record news and tell their own stories, share their stories with each other, be critical of the media and engage in dialogue with the reporting that's going on the news and actually shape the news narrative, is extremely powerful. It's an extremely democratic thing for us to have access to this at a time where things are really turning away from democracy in so many ways. Something else to be aware of, there's a lot of police persecution that's going on right now, and I have been witnessing it firsthand in Charlotte. I mean, I've always followed it at a distance in terms of following what's happening in other cities, but to actually be living in Charlotte in the past 3 weeks and actually witness this unfolding has been, I don't know what word to use for it. I mean, terrifying, among other things. But there is a lot of surveillance that is now going on social media in terms of using social media to track people's activism. This is also a racial and economic issue, because the majority of folks who own the media platforms, and including social media platforms, are white men, wealthy white men. The majority of users of social media are young people of color. And so this is really policing and in some ways removing their only platform of speaking from their experience. Something else really important to understand related to that, a lot of the most prominent cases in this modern movement we only know about because of social media. We don't know about it because it was reported in the press, including the Trayvon Martin case, including what happened in Ferguson. In fact, at one point during the Ferguson uprising, the FAA granted a no-fly zone to the St. Louis Police Department, who has since been investigated by the Department of Justice, just so we can understand. They granted a no-fly zone to the St. Louis Police Department, which prevented press from flying choppers overhead to see what was happening on the ground. The only way that we were able to keep up with what was happening was because people had cell phones and could live stream and tweet out to us what was actually happening. We also, during the uprising in Ferguson, you would see dialogue going on between folks in Palestine and people in Ferguson on how to deal with police throwing tear gas at you. Again, really extraordinary things, and it's to think about what it would be like if we did not have this right now is really gives you pause. What I like to point out, though, last thing, is that social media is not a replacement for traditional organizing, and I always like to emphasize that to people. It's a powerful tool for mobilization, it's a powerful tool for sharing information, but it's not a replacement for bare bones organizing. So when I'm at home in my community, we are still very much knocking on doors and passing out flyers and asking people to come sit and meet and talk. You know, a lot of times when we look at images from the 60s and we see these large marches, you could do that easily today by just sending out a tweet or a post, and you can have hundreds of people show up at a rally. But when I think about the process that it took to make such a moment like that in the past, that required meeting, that required a lot of face-to-face conversation, and there's a lot of value that comes from that in terms of building community, building that beloved community with people, and there's just no replacement for that. So I just always like to emphasize that. So to end, I want to end kind of as I began, with the question of what does it mean to be conscious? I believe it means to be aware of what a fantastic blessing it is to be alive in this moment, to be a human being, to be part of a species that has the power to create and shape a world where there is no hunger and thirst, where there is no violence and oppression. And I don't say that as a pie in the sky kind of notion, but as an actual fact that we live at a time in human history for the first time where poverty does not have to exist. Poverty and famine don't have to exist as a product of lack. We don't lack for anything, especially not in this nation. There's no reason for anyone to be hungry or without a home in this nation. And that's a blessing that we are at that place. We're not merely passive bystanders in the course of time. We're not a goldfish in a bowl that has no awareness of why it's swimming in circles. We are reflections of the divine creator, as beautifully diverse as every other species, yet blessed with an awareness of ourselves as an endlessly imaginative, creative force on this earth. I believe this is a generation of awakening, one that will and that already has in many ways changed the world. So once you become conscious of the time in which you live, the only question to then ask yourself is, what will be my contribution? Where will I jump in to help humanity lift itself up? Ask this of yourself. Answer it for yourself. And have the courage to act on your convictions. Thank you.
Stay on your feet. Lift every voice and sing number 149. all our diversity and behind all our differences, there is a unity which makes us one and binds us forever together in spite of time and death and the space between the stars. May it be so. Amen.